I've listened to so much crap in the last 2 weeks.
Hey, buddy.
You know, you hear all that crap, but I understood that that crap was going to come with the territory.
Hey, buddy.
But I'll live with the crap.
Buddy.
And I feel very good.
He's a disgruntled Scottish guard known for his lethal temper and his unusual eating habits. He weighs a metric ton. His name, Fat Bastard.
One of the things, Mike, that's been pointed out over the course of today and last night after the game is that you seem resigned to the fate after the game, that there wasn't much fire in you, and you sort of stood up before the media and said, well, you know, this is the way it is. Are you resigned to this fate?
Well, you're the same guy that wrote about me when I did have the fire, that was the wrong thing to do. So who are you crapping?
Well, I'm just asking.
Don't crap me.
No.
And Who Ya Crappin' is brought to you by Windy City Limousine, the official limousine of the Chicago White Sox, and you. As always, I'd like to limit this to something someone said, not something someone did. And please, Jason is itchy. He'll get you. Be brief if possible.
And avoid the partisan political craps. Political craps are okay, just not obviously partisan ones. We will start in Oak Park. With Beard.
Hello, boys.
Hello, Beard.
I just finished watching Religious for the first time, and now I'm scared. Anyway, once again, David Schuster has forced me to single him out this week. During Tuesday afternoon's press conference held by Theo Epstein, Jed Hoyer, and Jason McLeod, David decided to begin his question with some good old-fashioned ass-kissing, saying, "It's great to see you guys back together again. It's like the Beatles reuniting." Dude. Did you seriously just compare the three to what was arguably one of the greatest bands of all time? Even if today Paul and Ringo decided to get back together just to do a crappy Christmas special, comparing the Theo Trio to that would be like comparing the planet Mercury to the sun in size. David, stop saying things just to make me hate you, and who are you crapping?
Zombie Chris Henry says Tony Dungy Sunday night put the blame for Denver's loss on the whole team, including the defense.
Oh.
That, according to him, allowed 45 points.
Mm.
I, too, blame the entire team. I blame those unathletic Denver receivers who possess neither 90-inch vertical leaps nor the ability to catch passes with their feet. I blame the coaching staff for not running more of a college-style offense against a team of NFL talents. But I do not blame the defense for allowing 45 points. The Denver defense allowed 31 points. The other 14 were scored by Detroit's defense by way of return touchdowns from a certain quarterback's turnovers. Tony, if you and your merry band of religious weirdos don't believe in evolution, then there's no logical hope for Tim Tebow to become a decent NFL quarterback. So until there's a miracle, I can sit back and laugh. Well, probably for only another game or two. Tony Dungy, you alien-headed bastard, who you crapping?
Yeah, that's really kind of one you should knock down. But if you're Tony Dungy, I never thought of that until he mentioned it. Because I don't watch the pregame show on that.
In Elmhurst, it's Mr. Mouth on the
score. Oh, here he is.
Hey, Spuddy.
Hey,
buddy.
The Chicago office of the ADL can file this crap under little Danny Bernstein.
Hello.
Only yesterday, the man that Terry Boers affectionately calls a born penis did what he does best, breaking into an exasperated Dilbert Gottfried to scream for over 40 seconds straight at caller Jason, who had the temerity to render Ryan Sandberg's first name as something other than the crisp, dramatic monosyllable that is the apparent touchtone ne plus ultra of all civilized men, who happen to be total back named Dan Bernstein. It's Ryan. Good God. Huh. 6 minutes of showtime later, Dan bewailed the profane, scathing character of score listeners' responses to his own numerous and varied mistakes. Quote, even if it's the smallest mistake, the tiniest thing, like you misspeak or something, it's, you suck, you effing me, I want to kill your children. Aw, poor Dan. How unfortunate that people today shrilly overreact to simple common errors and mispronunciations. Alas, oh unkind orb. So I'll thank you, Mr. Bernstein, to bear in mind 3 points for future reference. First, it's pronounced McCannon. Second, unredden your prescriptive linguistics ass or at least don't complain about the color of other people's. And third, Dan Bernstein. Who you crapping?
This hour of Boys of Bernstein is brought to you by Northwestern Basketball. Nicely done, my friend.
This
exactly right.
Is from Schmutzy, who says,
wow.
Hugh Douglas told Skip Bayless that he loved what Lions linebacker Stephen Tulloch did, striking the instant classic Tebow pose after a sack, emphasizing that Tulloch was not mocking Tebow's faith. It's mocking Tim Tebow himself. He hasn't earned his stripes in the NFL, and yet he's this big thing. But Bayless chided Douglas for his insensitivity. Tisk, tisk, said Bayless, I take deep offense at this. Tim undercut me a little on Friday by saying he's okay with this, but if Tebow had been a Muslim or a Jewish player, would you parody his prayer pose? Well, yeah, I would. If Viking safety Hussein Abdullah rolled out a prayer rug to celebrate an interception, or if Gabe Karimi broke into some Ashkenazi hopping dance after a Matt Forte touchdown, I would parody the hell out of them because religious displays are out of place in a football game. We're not talking about a quick sign of the cross or a sky point. We're talking about what Bayless himself called a prayer pose. It's Pharisaic garbage, which makes it perfect for parody. But that's not even the point, because Skip Bayless was interviewed by Kyle Beck for Beacon Sports in September of 2009. When asked about the role of faith in his work, Bayless said, quote, I have written about my faith once for the New York Times and once for the Chicago Tribune in the context of a religious controversy, and I used my background in the church to bring perspective to, say, star athletes who publicly professed their devotion to God for only the PR value while living an ungodly life off camera. I've written that I pity the athletes who say God wanted us to win this game because I don't believe God decides games or that God favors one team because it outprays the other. Expressing devotion to God for PR purposes? I'm not sure whether that applies more to Tebow or Bayless, but since Tim Tebow's been such a good sport about the whole Tebowing thing and has turned the other cheek before letting the thing bother him too much, I'd suggest Skip Bayless ask himself two questions. What would Tebow do? And who are you crapping?
You could get him every week.
Yeah, but that's perfect. I mean, that's well researched.
That's it, yep.
In Elmhurst, it's Sean on the score. Hello, Sean.
Hi, how you doing?
Good, Sean.
Good luck with your first crap.
This crap goes out to the matriarch of the no-talent ass-clown family known as the Kardashians, Kris Jenner, who on, I believe it was Monday or Tuesday, was asked about the whole Kim divorce thing, asked to respect Kim's privacy in this difficult time. While I would maybe give her a pass if it was TMZ standing on her front door asking her this question, that was not the case. She happened to be on The View promoting a book called All Things Kardashian. So, Kris, I just have two questions for you. First, which pro sport athlete is your daughter going to victimize next? For irony's sake, I hope it's OJ. And two, who are you crapping?
Thank you. Here's one from Mr. Chainsaw. Says, this goes out to giant, whiny, bald-headed, megalomaniacal frontman of the Smashing Pumpkins and self-appointed baseball Bigfoot Billy Corgan, who called into Mully and Hanley to let them know that Theo Epstein, not even interviewing Ryan Sandberg for the Cubs managerial position, was childish. Well, Billy would be an expert on childish behavior at this point. The same guy who earlier this year took the time to resurrect a decades-old feud with another mid-90s self-important white people's favorite Pavement, hurling insult after insult via the most adult medium known to man, Twitter. Thanks. Corgan levels Pavement with the following crushing blow. I just found out Smashing Pumpkins is playing with Pavement in Brazil. It's going to be one of those New Orleans-type funerals. I say that because they represent the death of the alternative dream, and we follow with the affirmation of life part. Oh, funny boy. How those who pointed the big finger of sellout are the biggest offenders now. Just for clarity's sake, we've got a really rich 45-year-old white man lobbing the label of sellout at other rich 45-year-olds. Not to mention Corgan took time out of his day while thousands of miles away to phone into his hometown morning sports cavalcade to express his idiotic opinion as if it were more valuable than any other visor-wearing ass clown or 69 Cub geriatric. Such behavior is a bellwether of adulthood indeed. So, Billy, before you get back to touring in Scandinavia under the moniker of The Smashing Pumpkins with four studio musicians because you're such a penis the other original members of your group can't stand being around you, does your giant bald head rest comfortably at night dreaming alternative dreams knowing that Kurt Cobain offed himself because you were treating his crack whore wife as your personal... Whoa, I can't go there.
Oh, my God. Hold
gotta,
on a minute there.
I got to stop short of that. It's good. I got to stop short of that, and we'll just end it with who you crapping.
Give me 10 there, Mr. Official.
Yeah, if there was something
hold
in there.
On a minute
I didn't think he was going there, but, well, it's not wrong, but I have to stop that statement mid-statement.
Yeah, incorrect is a reason to stop, but other reasons as well.
Right. Unemployed lawyer is on the score.
You have to dump that?
I don't think so. That's a good question. What would you advise as my lawyer?
Well, you always say hooah, so I always figure
out. Oh, no. The word whore is fine. It's just the end of that with a certain thing that might have been going on, I can't say.
Oh, my God.
Whatever. Before I start, I just want to say I think the greatest revenge on Kim Kardashian for being such a greedy whore is that she's lusted after a bunch of creepy weirdos like you two bastards.
Hey.
Defending a recent marriage, Kim wrote this week, quote, "There are reports that I made millions of dollars off the wedding. These reports are simply not true." This rang a little hollow. I mean, Kim won't fart for less than $20,000. So I did a little research. Turns out the wedding episodes of her show gross 20 times as much as regular episodes. So there's her salary. Then there's stuff like her bachelorette party. Kim was paid $50,000 to host at a trendy Vegas nightclub. Her 20-plus carat ring worth $2 million was purchased at a fraction of the cost. Then there's the freebies, a Vera Wang wedding dress, the invitations, the cake. Even Kim's mom's pre-wedding facelift was allegedly comp. But even if all that doesn't add up to seven figures, Kim's still lying about not making millions because her honeymoon photos alone sold for $1.5 million. Kim Kardashian, I hope you get in the face with a flying Paula Deen. You crap.
I don't know why that image is just so funny.
Don't worry, she'll get hit in the face.
Yeah, but it won't be with a flying Paula Deen.
I don't think so, no.
This one from Jeff downtown says, Monday, Booyah Hobbit Buster Olney said that any negotiations of C.C. Sabathia's contract must consider the fact he's closing in on 300 wins. C.C. Sabathia has 176 wins. That is closing in on 300 wins about as much as Rosie O'Donnell is closing in on not fat. Buster, who you crapping? Gary from Evanston is on the score.
Hi, guys. Sebastian Cabot once played a crooked Spanish nobleman in the 1960 episode of Bonanza. Anyway,
only parts of him were crooked.
Anyway, this is almost too easy, but I still have to crap Rick Tellender for his incredibly stupid Tony La Russa column in Tuesday Sun-Times in which Tellender said, quote, "So bring back Tony, Jerry. Now, I'm very sorry that Rick has recently gone deaf, or otherwise he would have heard La Russa making absolutely no sense in most of his public comments over the past 2 weeks. The sad truth is that with the possible one-time exception of the National League All-Star team next year, La Russa is as likely to manage the White Sox or any other team as Pat Summitt is. Rick Tellender, who are you crapping?"
Wow. That's what we're doing. We're in the midst of who you crap on our
good
signature segment. We invite you to come on out and play. 312-644-6767. Who you crap on? Chicago Sports Radio 670 The Score. We are in the midst of our signature segment, Who You Crappin' Here on Chicago Sports Radio 670 The Score. Boers and Bernstein, we're talking to you, 312-644-6767. Been good so far, but as always, I'm looking for the big finish.
It's Uncivil Engineer on the score.
Ah.
Hi, guys.
Hey.
This is my first crap.
Good luck with your first crap.
Thank you. Calm, cool, collected. If I had three words to describe fiery Lions head coach Jim Sport, it would not be these three. However, Friday night on The Score, Lions play-by-play man Jim Brandstetter voiced this opinion, stating, quote, "Schwartz is a guy who doesn't get too high or too low." Mr. Brandstetter, there's a lot of ways I could go with this, but I'm going to keep it simple and just ask two questions. One, did you see the 49ers game? And two, who are you crapping?
Nice. Good one, Uncivil Engineer. Isaiah in Budlong Woods says this goes out to Rangers slugger and eight-time rehab champ Josh Hamilton. After the Rangers choked away Game 6 of the World Series, he said God told him he'd hit a home run as he walked up to the plate in the 10th inning. God told me you haven't hit one in a while, and this is the time you're going to, he said in a post-game interview. So sick of athletes using their public platform to glorify God. If you want to point to the sky after scoring a touchdown or drop to one knee in front of 80,000 people, fine. but spare us the ridiculous God whisperer bit. If God thinks you're so important, he needs to let you know you are due for a big hit, then I need a different God. Josh Hamilton, you thoughtless, narcissistic drug addict, who are you crapping?
Wow.
Pounding people today.
Oh, man.
Larry in Munster is on the score. Hello, Larry.
Hi, guys. How are you?
Great.
Good.
Good. This crap goes out to Matt Millen, who during last Saturday's broadcast on ESPN opined about the national championship chances of both Oklahoma and Oklahoma State. After comparing the relative strengths of both teams and finding himself undecided, Millen proclaimed, "You know what? I'll be neutral. I'll be Sweden." To which broadcast partner Sean McDonough replied, "I think you mean Switzerland." Millen's response, "Oh yeah, right, whatever. Sweden, Switzerland, they're all the same." Matt, Switzerland is a federal republic situated in Western Europe and hasn't been at war since 1815. They are, in fact, neutral. Sweden, by contrast, is a constitutional monarchy on the Scandinavian peninsula that expanded its territories primarily through acts of war. Definitely not neutral. The same, huh? Hey, Matt, you mouth-breathing, dim-witted, myopic Scandinavian historian, just one question. Who are you crapping?
Wow.
John in Streamwood, you're on the score.
Wow.
Hey, buddy.
Hey, buddy.
Hey, buddy.
This one goes out to P-Brain panelist J.A. Adonde, who on the Around the Horn said a couple weeks ago that Tim Tebow's mechanics really won't make a difference in the NFL. It doesn't matter how the ball gets there because he's a winner. J.A., if that really didn't matter, Chad Pennington's wide receivers wouldn't have to run three-yard out patterns all the time, and Antoine Randall would have been a quarterback and not a wide receiver. If you really want a glorified running back to play quarterback for you, Juice Williams can take time out of his busy day fathering children with women that aren't his wife to come play quarterback for you. J.A., who you crapping?
Sideswipe at Juice Williams is the second one of the week.
I did a couple sideswipes today, yeah.
I like it. I like sideswipes.
Mm-hmm. Well, the king of them.
In Morton Grove, Todd next on the score.
Hey, guys. This crap goes out to Jed Hoyer, who said, quote, "It's never a good idea to look outside to fix an organization's problems from the outside." Never? Really, Jed? Never like Boston signing or trading for David Ortiz, Manny Ramirez, Johnny Damon, Bill Miller, Josh Beckett, Pedro Martinez, and Dice K, to name a few? I think they helped win a couple World Series. Having lived in Chicago my whole life, I realize you're pandering to the dumbest bunch of goobers north of I-80, but you haven't been here a week. Next time you give it to me, have the decency to kiss me first, and who you crapping?
Thank you, Todd. This is a great one here from Denver Dave.
Oh, Denver Dave.
In the wake of Dan Weldon's fatal accident at Las Vegas Motor Speedway, IndyCar CEO Randy Bernard gave an interview to the AP, telling them, "The last week was probably the most horrific week of my life." I can imagine that statement to be true. However, later in the interview, Bernard stated, "I think anytime we're on any track, it's always dangerous. We do as much as we can to make it safe. And our storylines were never, come watch this dangerous event." Well, Randy, in June of this year, you gave an interview to the Toronto Globe and Mail, defending your decision to go to double-file restarts. Mm-hmm. You stated that the change would mean more, quote, "carnage and wrecks," and added that, quote, "danger will be an important element of the sport." On top of that, you started 34 cars on a track that your own rule book says the maximum safe car count is 28. Additionally, the now-departing face of your series, Danica Patrick, stated in an interview hyping the race that, quote, "the crashes will be spectacular." Given all that, it seems your storyline indeed was, "come watch this dangerous event." Randy Bernard, who are you crapping?
Really good.
Marv Albert's pool boy is on WSCR.
Hello, boy.
Hello.
I'm going to direct this at the Scores production staff because I really don't know who else to direct it to, but I'm going to give it a try. Last week, when you guys were announcing the inception of Theo Epstein, you were waxing poetic for at least 20 minutes on how we should get they should get rid of the I'm drawing a blank here, boy. I'm sorry. You get rid of the ridiculous things like "Go Cubs win" and the seventh inning stretch. Just went on for 20 minutes, and then came a commercial break where immediately following, big voice guy came in announcing the inception of Theo Epstein, and in the background was playing
today, Junior.
Yeah, I hear you. So, score production staff, who you crapping?
That was all kinds of wrong, but all right.
All kinds of wrong. Let me not count them all and
Adam
move on.
In Buffalo Grove says, this goes out to PETA. I guess these guys thought we'd forgotten about them or something, because last week they decided to file a lawsuit alleging that SeaWorld keeping five killer whales is a violation of the 13th Amendment, which, to whoever didn't pay attention in school, read everyone listening to the show, is the amendment that ended slavery. That's right. PETA is saying that the whales are unjustly enslaved in violation of the U.S. Constitution. And I must have forgotten the line in the preamble where it says, we, the various vertebrates of the United States. Wow. You know what? Let's take it all the way. Animals protected by the Constitution, give them liquor, give them guns. This is what the country needs. More dumb, drunken animals shooting things. When was the last time PETA did something that didn't make anyone with a heart cringe? I'm not insensitive to the mistreatment of animals, but neither am I willing to respect an animal's right to vote. There's so much absurdity in everything PETA does, from demeaning advertisements objectifying women, to announcing its intent to create a porn website that draws the attention to the plight of animals. The hell do they plan on putting there? Their ads and actions make me want to punch a baby cow in the face, snap its neck, and eat it raw. PETA, next time you want to raise awareness over the mistreatment and abuse of animals, choose a way that doesn't numb the public to your message. That celebrities will walk around naked if you give them a ham sandwich. Here's two quotes. One, however much I may sympathize with and admire worthy motives, I'm an uncompromising opponent of violent methods even to serve the noblest of causes. And two, who you crapping?
Who's that from?
That is from Adam in Buffalo Grove.
Wow.
Nice, huh?
My people. There you go. Thank you, Adam.
Here is Gouvernement Fromage on the score.
This week's pièce de poupe goes to my guy and the score's very own Dan Bernstein.
Hi.
The other day, Dan told everyone who listens to the show that he openly tells the phone solicitor for Oberweis Dairy that he doesn't order their products because he has strong feelings about the owner, Jim Oberweis's, politics. Fair enough. Except yesterday, while discussing Herman Cain and his god-awful Godfather pizza...
Yeah, you got me.
Dan let slip that he likes Domino's pizza, despite his feelings about the various goings-on.
Yep, I knew this was coming.
Owner. So you'll secretly sneak out to feast on Domino's, but when it comes to dairy products, that's where your opinions firm up.
Yeah.
Dan, love your suit, your show, and your tweets. But ooh, Abel Crappin.
Yeah, that's very nice. That's wheelhouse.
Right on it,
that's,
too.
That's right there. Yep, guilty as charged. Scott in Woodstock, you are on the score.
Good evening, gentlemen.
Hello, Scott.
Hello.
This crap goes out to Hub Arkish, who last night, when answering to the people on the Bears, if the four consecutive night games had any effect on the players, and Hub responded that they're professional athletes, it should have no effect on them. Hub, among many other NFL experts, tell us every season that football players are creatures of habit. They don't like to change their schedule in any shape, fashion, or form. Well, four consecutive night games for people who are used to playing noon games seems like a big change to me. So even though I don't have any clever send-off, Hub Arkish, will you crap it?
That's all you need. Terry, please check your manometer.
I've checked it. It's ready because it's really, really very good today. But I've got a double one for you where I got it.
You got it from Manfred Mann?
That's where I got it.
And his Earth Band?
And his Earth Band. Mm-hmm.
And here to bear the pressure with poetic aplomb to close out who you crapping is Dark Twain on the score.
This crap is for Ann Coulter, who described the reporting of sexual harassment charges against Herman Big Daddy Cain as another high-tech lynching, because our blacks are better than their blacks. Of course, on the day of a real high-tech lynching, Coltergeist tweeted, hold the pickles, hold the lettuce, frying killers won't upset us. One Troy Davis, plain broil, please. White supremacist Lawrence Russell Brewer was executed on the same day as Troy Davis. Lawrence Russell Brewer admittedly was one of three men who took a black man, beat him, urinated on his unconscious body, and dragged him to his death behind their pickup truck. Troy Davis maintained his innocence to the very end. Seven of nine eyewitnesses later recanted their story. May God bless the soul of Troy Davis and Lawrence Russell Brewer. High-tech lynching. Our blacks. Their blacks. I guess me, Mandingo. Ann Coulter. Swallow my words of wisdom before you spit more ignorance out your mouth or choke on Mandingo. say my ick day, itch bay. I just asked her in pig Latin, who you crap.
No, we can't. That's...
Oh, no, 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 no.
You make us wonder with the things
Art Twain's a little edgy today, wasn't it? Hey, buddy! A little edgy. Art Twain, you got to reel that in a little bit. We love you, but...
Hey, buddy!
Hey, buddy!
Ooh, you crap.
Wow, yeah. It really...
It was great that at the end that pig Latin does not shield you from the...